In this case study, we're going to look at the design of a high-power amplifier. This amplifier is designed for WiMAX, and there are transistors available from transistor vendors that are particularly optimized for WiMAX applications. WiMAX is 3.4 to 3.8 GHz, and the output power in this design, at 1 dB gain compression, is that it needs to be 28 dBm. That image there is the final design and layout of the WiMAX amplifier, and we're going to go through the stages that lead to that design. Here are some things that we need to know about before we enter into this type of design. For one, it is necessary to use nonlinear simulation, and harmonic balance analysis is preferred. In harmonic balance analysis, the key idea is that we assume that there is one discrete tone, one sine wave, or maybe a few discrete tones. We are very concerned about nonlinear distortion, we're concerned about gain compression, and 1 dB gain compression is a very good metric and the most widely used metric that indicates the level of distortion. Our criterion is that the maximum sine wave in a modulated signal, such as a digitally modulated signal, must just experience 1 dB gain compression, and the average power of the digitally modulated signal will be backed off from that 1 dB gain compression level by the peak-to-mean envelope power ratio. Thermal heat sinking is very important. That is a consideration right up front in the layout and the architecture and how we're going to mount this amplifier. We must consider possible layout at the beginning. Well, it turns out that there are only a few possible layouts. So we have to have a topology in mind. Perhaps there are four or five layouts that work for this type of amplifier that we're designing. Not a very large number, but there are lots of little twists. And here our specifications are that we want a 28 dBm output power. When that is indicated, that is referring to the 1 dB gain compression point, and we need to operate from 3.4 to 3.8 GHz. That is a little bit over 10%. That means that the design can be quite challenging. Here is our high-level architecture, our high-level topology. Key components are that we have a 50 ohm input and we have a 50 ohm output. So our amplifier will be driven perhaps by an earlier amplifier stage which has an output impedance of 50 ohms, and we're going to drive 50 ohms. One of the issues with high-power amplifiers is that the output resistance of the transistor, the resistive part at least, is going to be in the range of half an ohm to 1 ohm to 2 ohms, something really quite small. And we need to go from that 1 ohm type level up to 50 ohms. So up front we know that the output matching network is going to be our biggest challenge. At the input of the transistor is going to have an input resistance something like 50 ohms or 100 ohms or 200 ohms, somewhere along that line. And we're going to go from 50 ohms to, well, if we go to 50 ohms, we don't need much of an input matching network, but if we go from 50 ohms to 200 ohms, it is not nearly as difficult a design challenge. Bias network, our gate bias and our drain bias, needs to be integrated into our matching network design. These values shown here are the final numbers with a finished design. May as well include them here. Here's another part of our architecture choice. Design is using a Class AB amplifier architecture. In a Class A design, we would be on our DC load line around about here, and our AC load line will go up and down this DC load line. Well, it could actually be offset a little bit, but at least the AC load line is largely following a straight line. There will be a little bit of looping of our AC load line, and that's because of parasitics in the transistor mostly. Class A design will have an operating point here so that we can have maximum signal swing, and the top and bottom of our swing is saturated or compressed at about the same power level. Class B design would be down here. Class B design is a very efficient design. The DC power we consume is proportional to the RF power. If our RF signal is very small, so too will be our DC signal. However, our Class B design has a lot of distortion. So the compromise is somewhere between Class A and Class B, which is called Class AB. In design, what we're doing is we're going to go and start at Class A and move down towards Class B design until we get that maximum level of distortion that we can tolerate. Well, maybe we won't start at Class A in a design, we'll start in Class AB somewhere. Based on experience, we'll have an idea of how far down we can go. Transistor selection is very important. Now, this is not the transistor that we're using in this design. The transistor in this design is a gallium nitride HEMT transistor. It's a FET. But this is a good picture, and this is representative of the type of thing that is done with transistors which are designed for particular applications. Let's look at this. This is a pretty big transistor. It is about a centimeter across. And what we have is a gate, a wide gate lead. We have a gate connection. We have a drain connection, and we have a source connection. In fact, the back of the die is our source. And this at the bottom here is a carrier, and so there will be multiple vias that will take us to the back of our semiconductor, and the semiconductor will be chemically bonded, that is valence level bonded to metal, and that metal will be mounted on our carrier. So we have a source which is really quite big, and it is the whole backing, and that source will be mounted on a carrier, a metal carrier. We have regions here where we can apply screws. Let's look inside here in some detail. We see three die that are indicated. So in fact, our transistor looks like multiple small transistors in parallel. Each of the dies has many gate fingers and many drain fingers, and so each of the die looks like a lot of transistors in parallel as well. Coming in from the gate, we see a bond wire. That bond wire has an inductance. We have a capacitor CA, so it's a broad capacitance here that's going down to our source, which is our ground connection. Then we have another inductor, another set of bond wires here, which provides some more inductance, another capacitor, and then a little bit more bond wire onto the die. So what we have in the gate is a series L, a shunt C, a series L, a shunt C, and a very small series L. These bond wires and capacitances are designed as a matching network. We say that this transistor is internally matched. We're going to design the input of the transistor and hopefully get 50 ohms. The output, let's start off at the die, we have a little bit of inductance. Then we have another capacitor, a bit more inductance, and then we have the drain. Unlikely that we'd ever be able to achieve the type of matching at the output that we could at the input. Output resistance from the die, from the drain terminals of the die, is going to be in that 1 ohm range, and we're going to try and get up to 50 ohms. But there's a little bit of matching. The particular transistor that we're using here, here are our IV curves, our output characteristics, with the drain current, ID, plotted against VDS. And these are lines of constant VGS. The lines across here are constant VGS. DC bias applied to our transistor applies 50 volts to the drain source connection. Now 50 volts is a magic number, because at 50 volts and below, you do not need to take special precautions about electrocution. The government health limits set 50 volts as the level at which, the voltage level at which, you do not have to apply special precautions against electrocution. Above that, do. These gallium nitride transistors can work up to very high voltages, like 100 volts. But if we operate at 100 volts, the safety precautions become rather extreme. You can't simply have an open die in the lab and work on that. Remember, we want to get 28 dBm out from our transistor, which is a little bit less than a watt. So we're going to design this so that we have 100 milliamp DC at our quiescent point. So here's 100 milliamp DC at our quiescent point. Here's our 50 volts. So at that point, we have a quiescent point. We're drawing 5 watts of DC. And so we choose VGS as about minus 1.1 volt to achieve that quiescent point. So we set this voltage as our drain voltage supply, and we adjust VGS to get the drain current that we want. Our load line is going to look something like that. We're not sure exactly where the load line will be. It will change during our design. And our AC load line and our DC load line really will not be the same. We don't expect them to be the same because our transistor at AC is going to see a different impedance level than it is going to see at DC. But notionally, that's what we're thinking of. We're thinking that this is our class AB quiescent point and our signal is going to wander up and down here. Sometimes the transistor vendor suggests that this is the quiescent point for WiMAX operation. So the transistor vendor has already built an amplifier. They do a reference design internally. They're trying to get their transistor to work in a WiMAX amplifier, and the only way to make sure that it works well is to build a WiMAX amplifier. So this could be the suggested operating point from our vendor, in which case the vendor provides S parameters. But if you're a big company and you're going into this to make a lot of units, you'll determine the optimum operating point yourself and you will measure the S parameters. And it's not easy to measure S parameters of a high power device under test. Here are two of our S parameters, S11 and S22. Here is our operating frequency range, 3.4 to 3.8 GHz. Let's look at S11 first. What is this telling us? Here we have almost a perfect match. If we're not told otherwise, our scattering parameters refer to 50 ohms. So these are 50 ohm parameters. In this region here, at this frequency, which is around about 4.4 gigahertz or so, 4.3 to 4.4 gigahertz, we have a very good match. The input of our transistor looks like 50 ohms. So we're looking into our transistor. There's an internal matching network, and then there's the active device, the die itself. Here it looks like 50 ohms. Backing off a little bit, we're pretty close to 50 ohms with a little bit of capacitance. Looking at the output now, looking at S22. Looking at S22, things don't look very good as far as a match goes. These are 50 ohm S parameters, and when we fit a model to S22, the magnitude and phase, see that the output of our transistor over that 3.4 to 3.8 gigahertz range looks like a 33 ohm resistor in parallel with a 4.4 picofarad capacitor. That's probably pretty close to the physics, but remember our output consists of our active device, the drain of our active device, and a small matching network. The impedance over that frequency range is pretty close to 2.5 minus J11 ohms. That indicates that the output resistance is about 2.5 ohms and we have some series capacitance. We could use this model or this model if we're trying to do an image amplifier design. Probably this model could be better. Here we're not going to do an image model design. That works very well if we're operating at fairly low power levels. But here we're going to have to use nonlinear design, so the image model could help get us started, but not necessarily. Key points here. The output resistance is 2.5 ohms, so we have to get rid of the reactants, and then we're left with the task of going from 2.5 ohms to 50 ohms, which is a big task. That's a big ratio to accomplish, a factor of 20. Here, gosh, the input really doesn't need to be matched. It's so close to being ideal. Our focus should be on getting that output matching network right. That's going to have the biggest effect on performance. Looking at S21 and S12 now, here is our operating frequency range. See that what the transistor has done with the matching network is they put a premium on making S21 flat in this frequency range. Normally, S21 falls off linearly with respect to frequency, or maybe not quite linearly, but it falls off with respect to frequency. The internal capacitive parasitics of our transistor FET intrinsically has an S21 that falls off. It's one of the reasons why people sometimes like to use bipolar transistors, such as a HBT transistor, because a bipolar transistor has a fairly constant S21. I'm betting here that the transistor vendor has optimized the input matching network so that we have something close to 50 ohms looking into our transistor, and they've optimized the output matching network to try and make S21 flat. So here is our design concept. We must have an idea in mind as to what type of layout we're going to have. So some big takeaways from here. On the bottom here is a metal carrier, a brass carrier. This brass carrier could be 5 millimeters or 7 millimeters thick, something like that. Here is our transistor. It's about a centimeter or maybe even a little bit more across. We have screws that mount that transistor on the metal carrier. And below the transistor, we could have a thermal paste, which improves the thermal connection between the transistor and the base. So the base is very solid, really quite heavy. We have an input matching network, and we have an output matching network. And in the next part, we're going to talk more about those matching networks and the design. Certainly the input is fairly compact, the output is fairly compact. Some immediate takeaways are that we have left metal wherever we can. So this here is a ground plane, and we can see lots of little vias here. That prevents parallel plate waveguide transmission through our substrate. We have a large ground here. We'll probably connect over to that ground. We could bond to that ground, or we could simply rely on a metal carrier being a ground. Our input matching network is fairly compact, and so is our output matching network.